What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. So, what is garbage collection in Java? Simply put, it is the process of automatically reclaiming unused memory by destroying unused objects. You see, in languages like C and C++, the programmer is responsible for both the creation and destruction of objects, and sometimes the programmer may forget to destroy useless objects. Hence, the used memory of the system will keep growing in this case, leading eventually to what we call memory leaks. After a certain point, memory won't be available anymore to create new objects, and the entire application will terminate due to out-of-memory errors. In Java, garbage collection happens automatically during the lifetime of a program. This eliminates the need to deallocate memory and therefore avoids memory leaks. Java garbage collection is the process by which Java programs perform automatic memory management. You see, Java programs compile into bytecode that can run on a Java virtual machine. When Java programs run on the JVM, objects are created in the heap space, which is a portion of memory dedicated to the program. Inside this space and over the lifetime of a Java application, new objects are created and released. And at any point in time, the heap memory consists of two types of objects, alive or dead. Alive objects are being used and referenced from somewhere else. Dead objects are no longer used or referenced from anywhere in the application, and it's these objects that are detected by the GC and deleted to free up memory. Now we know that the garbage collector detects and deletes unused objects from the heap space, but how exactly does it work in Java? Well, there are various ways in which the reference to an object can be released to make it a candidate for garbage collection. Some of them are by making a reference null, or by assigning a reference to another, or by using an anonymous object. Keep in mind that everything we mentioned is automated. The programmer does not need to explicitly mark objects to be deleted. Okay, you should know that the garbage collection implementation lives in the JVM, and each JVM can implement its own version of garbage collection. Now, to perform garbage collection or write your garbage collector, you should include in your implementation three main phases. First, marking objects as alive. In this step, the GC identifies all the alive objects in memory by traversing the object graph. When GC visits an object, it marks it as accessible and thus alive. Every object the garbage collector visits is marked as alive. All the objects which are not reachable are considered candidates for garbage collection. The second phase is sweeping dead objects. After marking each object as alive or dead, the sweep phase releases the memory fragments which contain these dead objects. Finally, in the third and last phase, the remaining objects in memory are compacted. The dead objects that were removed during the sweep phase may not necessarily be next to each other, thus you can end up with fragmented memory space. This phase ensures that the memory is compact after the garbage collector deletes the dead object, so that the remaining objects are in a contiguous block at the start of the heap. But wait, having to mark and compact all the objects in a JVM every single time is inefficient. It must be, right? Well, yes, it is. And to solve this, Java garbage collectors implement a generational garbage collection strategy that categorizes objects by age, often called generational garbage collection. You see, as more and more objects are allocated, the list of objects grows, leading to longer garbage collection times. And in fact, several analyses of applications have shown that most objects have a very short lifespan. To benefit from these findings, the heap memory area in the JVM was divided into three sections. The young generation, which consists of newly created objects and is further subdivided into the Eden space and the survivor spaces. All the new objects start in the Eden and initial memory is allocated to them. If an object survives one GC cycle, then they are moved to survivor spaces. When objects are garbage collected from the young generation, it is a minor garbage collection event. A minor GC is performed when the Eden space is filled with objects, either dead or alive. All the dead objects are deleted and all the live objects are moved to one of the survivor spaces. Take this sequence as an example. Suppose Eden is filled with objects, alive and dead, so a minor GC should occur. All dead objects are removed from Eden and all alive objects are moved to the from space. Eden and to space are now empty. New objects are created and added to Eden. Some objects in from space become dead as well. Minor GC occurs, all dead objects are removed from Eden and from space, all alive objects are moved to space, Eden and from space are now empty. So at any time, one of the survivor spaces is always empty. When the surviving objects reach a certain threshold of moving around the survivor spaces, they are moved to the old generation. The old generation is the second out of the three sections we mentioned. Objects that are alive long enough are eventually moved from the young generation to the old generation. It contains objects that have remained in the survivor spaces for a long time. When objects are garbage collected from the old generation, it is a major garbage collection event. So, the cycle we previously saw will be repeated for a specific number of times. If the object is still used after this point, the next garbage collection cycle will move it to the old generation space. The third and final generation we have is the permanent generation. Metadata such as classes and methods are stored in the permanent generation. It is populated by the JVM at runtime based on classes in use by the application. Starting with Java 8, the metaspace memory space replaced the permgen space. The implementation differs from the permgen as the space of the heap is now automatically resized. This avoids the problem of applications running out of memory due to the limited size of the permgen space of the heap. The metaspace memory can be garbage collected and the classes that are no longer used can be automatically cleaned when the metaspace reaches its maximum size. Okay, now that we know how the JC operates, let's take a look at different types of garbage collectors available in the Java virtual machine. First, the serial GC. This is the simplest implementation of GC and is designed for small applications running on single-threaded environments. All garbage collection events are conducted serially in one thread. When it runs, it leads to a stop the world event where the entire application is paused. Now, the parallel GC, the parallel collector is intended for applications with medium-sized to large-sized datasets that run on multi-threaded hardware. Multiple threads are used for minor garbage collection in the young generation, and a single thread is used for major garbage collection in the old generation. Running the parallel GC also causes a stop the world event and freezes the application. So, since it is more suitable in a multi-threaded environment, it can be used when a lot of work needs to be done and long pauses are acceptable. Next is the concurrent mark sweep, or CMS GC. Multiple threads are used for minor and major garbage collection. CMS runs concurrently alongside application processes to minimize stop the world events. Because of this, the CMS collector uses more CPU than other GCs. So, if you can allocate more CPU for better performance, then the CMS garbage collector is a better choice than the parallel collector. Now, the garbage first, or G1 GC, also chosen as the default collector by Java. G1 GC was intended as a replacement for CMS and was designed for multi-threaded applications that have a large heap size available. It is parallel and concurrent like CMS, but it works quite differently under the hood compared to the old garbage collectors. Although J1 is also generational, it does not have separate regions for young and old generations. Instead, each generation is a set of regions which allows resizing of the young generation in a flexible way. It partitions the heap into a set of equal-sized regions and uses multiple threads to scan them. A region might be either an old region or a young region at any time during the program run. After the marked phase is completed, G1 knows which regions contain the most garbage objects. If the user is interested in minimal pause times, G1 can choose to evacuate only a few regions. If not, G1 might choose to include more regions. Since G1 GC identifies the regions with the most garbage and performs garbage collection on that region first, it is called garbage first. Next is the Epsilon garbage collector. Epsilon is a do-nothing garbage collector that was released as part of JDK 11. It handles memory allocations but does not implement any actual memory reclamation mechanism. Once the available Java heap is exhausted, the JVM shuts down. It can be used for ultra-latency sensitive applications where developers know the application memory footprint exactly or even have completely garbage-free applications. Use of the Epsilon GC in any other scenario is otherwise discouraged. Now, the Shenandoah GC. Shenandoah is a new GC that was released as part of JDK 12. Shenandoah's key advantage over G1 is that it does more of its garbage collection cycle work concurrently with the application threads. G1 can evacuate its heap regions only when the application is paused, while Shenandoah can relocate objects concurrently with the application. Shenandoah can compact live objects, clean garbage, and release RAM back to the OS almost immediately after detaching free memory. Since all of this happens concurrently while the application is running, Shenandoah is more CPU intensive. Finally, the ZGC. ZGC is another GC that was released as part of JDK 11 and has been improved in JDK 12. It is intended for applications which require low latency and/or use a very large heap. The primary goals of ZGC are low latency, scalability, and ease of use. To achieve this, ZGC allows a Java application to continue running while it performs all garbage collection operations. Thus, ZGC brings a significant improvement over other traditional GCs by providing extremely low pause times. Okay, in the last section of this video, I want to discuss a couple advantages of garbage collection in Java. First, it makes your code simple. You don't have to worry about proper memory assignment and release cycles. You just stop using an object in your code and the memory it is using will be automatically reclaimed at some point. Additionally, it makes Java memory efficient because the garbage collector removes the unreferenced objects from heap memory. This frees the heap memory to accommodate new objects. While some programmers argue in favor of manual memory management over garbage collection is now a standard component of many popular programming languages. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.